Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at LoveIsrael.org. That's one word, LoveIsrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
Order is important to God. We could say this, without following God's order, it is impossible to be pleasing to Him. If you're not following the order of God, you will not be in His will. You cannot accomplish His purposes, and you won't arrive in the location that God wants you to be in. So we need to affirm God's order in general and specifically in our life. Take out your Bible and look with me to the book of Matthew and chapter 15. The book of Matthew, chapter 15. Now, the portion of scripture that we're going to be looking at this evening is difficult for many people. And why is that? Because Yeshua, Jesus of Nazareth, He seems out of character. How He behaves, what He says at first glance to many, He seems uncaring. We're going to meet a woman who comes before Him in grief and sorrow because her daughter is sick. Her daughter is being afflicted. And what does she want? As any mother does, she wants help. She wants someone to put things in order. But here's the key. If we don't follow God's order, if we don't affirm His will, then we are not going to experience His order in our life. But if we affirm His order, if we begin to submit to His will, we're going to find God's order, His purposes, what He wants to manifest in our life. It's going to become a reality. So this portion of scripture is very significant, and it helps us understand so many other passages we find in the scripture. So again, look with me to that 15th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew and verse 21. We read, "And Yeshua went out from there." Now the word "went out" is the same word that relates to the children of Israel going out of Egypt. And we know that the Exodus from Egypt relates to redemption. And even though this is a different language than Hebrew, it's Greek, it is parallel to that Hebrew concept of going out. Therefore, when we look at this passage, we see that there is a redemptive character to what we see here. And once more, it is redemption that puts us where God wants us to be. Why? So we can do the things that God would have us to do. And that all begins by us saying yes to God, affirming His order in our life and in everything else related to His will, His plan, His program for this world. So once again, "And Yeshua went out from there, and He withdrew into the regions of Tyre and Sidon." These are two cities in Lebanon. So something stands out. Messiah has left the promised land. He's no longer in Galilee. He's not in Judea, but rather He's in Lebanon. And why specifically there? And furthermore, why in these two cities? Because during this period of time, 2,000 years ago, there were many Jewish individuals that lived in Tyre and Sidon. They were in exile, and God's message of the gospel, His plan of salvation, how one can find forgiveness of their sins and experience restoration to the will of God, that message, just wasn't for the Jewish people living in the land of Israel, but for all the children of Jacob. So uniquely, we find him going out of the borders of Israel into Lebanon to these two communities that had a great deal of Jewish people. So when we read this, it shouldn't surprise us that he would be going to fellow Jewish individuals. But notice what we find, verse 22. That key word, behold. Now, whenever that word behold appears in the scripture, be assured, something significant is going to happen. Something that oftentimes surprises us. And that's where the wisdom, the message of the passage of this scripture is found. We read, and behold, a Canaanite woman. Now, the word Canaanite comes from a Hebrew origin. It means to submit. And we're going to find when we look at the Old Testament, what did we learn? The Canaanites weren't interested in the things of God. They were not committed to the will of God. And what happened to them? They experienced God's judgment. In short, he wasn't pleased with them. But behold, this woman is going to be different. This woman is going to be a model for all people, both Jew and Gentile alike. Now, we need to remember something. The Bible says God is not a respecter of a person, meaning God does not have a favored group of people. You say, well, what about the Jewish people? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that we are his favorite people. He simply chose us, and here's the key, according to his order, according to his plan, his purpose, his will. He chose the sons of Jacob, the daughters of Jacob, in order to fulfill his purpose. So it's not a favorite people, it's a chosen people. And the key is this, are the nations, meaning the Gentiles, are they going to affirm God's order, his program, his plan to accomplish his will? This is what this passage is about. And we read verse 22, and behold, a Canaanite woman from these regions. And she went out. Now, here's the key. That same word, when it says that Messiah went out from there, now we see that same verb being used for her. She too went out from there. And where did she go? Here's the key. That same word tells us that she shares in the purpose of Messiah. He was going there to speak redemption to his fellow Jews in exile. But she too was interested in the things of God, in the purposes of God. And what this passage is going to do for us, the reader, is to show Yeshua testing her. And this woman, this Gentile woman, she is going to pass the tests in an excellent way. Once more. Behold, a Canaanite woman went out from these regions, and she did something. She proclaimed, and that means with a loud voice, she proclaimed to him, saying, have mercy upon me, O Lord. Now, notice the first thing that she did was to ask for mercy. And there is so much wisdom in that fact. God is not going to do much in your life. You're not going to experience his power. You're not going to understand his purposes. You are not going to be a recipient of his provisions in your life until, first and foremost, you seek his mercy. It's only when we ask for mercy sincerely do we recognize our spiritual condition and how much in need of him that we are, for him to be the center of our life. So let me ask you a question. When was the last time you beseech God for mercy. That you cried out. Look at that word. It is an intense word. She cried out. She proclaimed. And what did she say? Very simply, have mercy upon me, Lord, Son of David. Now, here's this Canaanite woman, but she affirmed something. She affirmed him as Lord. This is significant. She recognized him, and the next thing she said was, Son of David. That is a term, there's no disagreement with this in any of the scholars. The term Son of David is an idiom for Messiah. She recognized him as Messiah, and not just one sent by God, but the Lord. And she came before him seeking mercy. And why did she want mercy, him to get involved in her life? Very simply, the text says here, she speaks and says to him, my daughter. And the next word in the Greek text, the word kakos, means evilly. It speaks itself of something outside of God's will, something that is against God's purposes. And she says, my daughter, evilly, meaning against God's will, is being possessed, afflicted by a demon. Now, we see so many times the Word of God, the New Covenant, talking about demons. And there's no way for us to affirm that we believe in Yeshua, Jesus Christ, and what he did, and then to not realize that there is a spiritual enemy, that devil, and there's demonic influence in this world. And it's only when we affirm the things of God are we going to have the resources provided to us through the Holy Spirit, whereby we can live a victorious life. What's that? Accomplishing the will of God, doing what's pleasing to him. That's what's success. That's the proper understanding of prosperity in this world, having everything you need to bring honor and glory to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the one true God, the God of Israel. So she says, my daughter evilly is afflicted by demons, demon possessed. But, and here's the key, verse 23, this is where it seems odd. Yeshua does not seem his normal character, this compassionate one. So many times the scripture says he was moved with compassion and he did something. But here, verse 23, but he did not answer her a word. Imagine that. Not responding at all when she says, this Gentile woman, a Canaanite woman, have mercy upon me. You're the Lord. You're the Messiah. And you know, one of the purposes of Messiah, I've shared with you a few times in the past, that he's thought of as bringing repair to this world. We can think of him as the great repairer. He fixes things. He puts things in the order of God. That's what she wants. She doesn't want her daughter possessed, afflicted evilly by a demon. But nevertheless, here, there's no response from Yeshua. He did not answer her a word. Second part of verse 23. And his disciples came to him and beseeched him, saying, send her away, because she cries out after us as well. So she, when she got no response from Yeshua, she turned just as intensely. She turned to his disciples, wanting to get them to plead her case, beseech Yeshua in her behalf. And what was their response? They didn't show much compassion. They didn't show much interest in this situation. And they did not do anything other than say to Yeshua, send her away. And the implication is, she's annoying us as well. We don't want this woman around us. Verse 24. But he answered and said, I was not sent Now he's speaking to the woman. He's giving her a response why he's not doing anything, apparently. He says, I was not sent except for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Now, you would think that that would eliminate this woman. She's a Canaanite. But realize something. The sheep of Israel, they're supposed to follow the great shepherd and accomplish, do what the shepherd says. And Israel, and we talked about this a few minutes ago, a chosen people, a purpose. What is that purpose? To bring blessings upon all the families of the earth. So he says, I was only sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But realize, Israel. Paul speaks about the commonwealth of Israel. And that helps us understand that we're talking about Israel as a kingdom term. All of those who are in the kingdom of God for eternity, they are part of the commonwealth of Israel. The kingdom of Israel is a word that speaks about God's eternal destination, the New Jerusalem. And notice this woman's response. She hears that. I was only sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, verse 25. And she came and worshiped him. Imagine that. Now, many would hear that and be angry, turn away, walk away, be angry at him. But she did not. She came closer to him. Nothing had changed. He's still the Lord. He is still the Messiah, the Son of David. He is the one that's supposed to bring restoration through the work of redemption to this world. And therefore, she hears that. And she didn't depart, but she drew closer to him. It says she came and she worshiped him, saying, Lord, help me. Just that simple. What she's saying is this. What you just said about being sent to the lost sheep of Israel, that doesn't eliminate me from my daughter being healed, my daughter being restored, that demonic influence being rid from her life. She says, you can still help me. Verse 26, but he answered and said, it is not good. Meaning, it's not God's will to take the bread of the children and to cast it to the dogs. Now, many people hear that and they are shocked by what he said. Is he equating Gentiles with dogs and Jews as the children of God? Is that what this passage is saying? Is this what we should take away from it? And I know a lot of Bible teachers that just kind of ignore that passage or try to explain it in a different way. What is at the heart of what he's teaching here? What I said at the very beginning. And that is God's order. He is not saying Jews are children and Gentiles and dogs. That's not what he's saying. He's speaking about an order. He's giving an example at a home, all homes, that they have dogs. Who eats first? Now, in that day and age, there was no Purina dog food. You didn't go to a store to buy food specifically for a dog. They ate the leftovers. So leftovers, this teaches us an order. First, the family ate. The children were satisfied. And once they completed eating, that which remained was given to the dogs. It's the order. And what he's saying is this. First Messiah was sent to the lost sheep of Israel to bring them to repentance, to restore them to the truth of God. Why? Because it's through Israel. That's his chosen vessel in order to bless the Gentiles, to bless the nations, to bless all the families of the earth. That's what God desires. Remember what it says in the book of Romans, chapter 1 and verse 16. It says, the gospel is power. To the Jew first and also to the Gentile. Here Gentile means, or Greek means Gentile. So here it's simply speaking about order once more. How that gospel began in Jerusalem, and then Judea, Samaria, and then to the outermost parts of the earth. So that's what this passage is about. God's order. So he says these words, I was only sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and it is not good to take the bread for the children and give it. And the implication is directly to the dogs. And what is her response? Verse 27. This woman, she agrees always with Yeshua. What a wise thing to do. Agree with the word of God. Agree with the order of God, the plans of God, the purpose of God. That's all this is about. She says, yes, Lord. Now, this is the third time that she calls him Lord. The number three, to reveal something. See, she affirmed him as Lord no matter what. Didn't matter what he said, what he did, he is the Lord. And he says, she says in a very strong way here, the Greek word nai, certainly Lord, yes, Lord. For the children eat. Is that what it says? No, the dogs. The dogs eat from the scraps that fall from the table of their masters. This word for eat means presently. She's saying, yes, the children get the food first, but the dogs also eat at that same time, just a little bit later. But it's now, it's at that mealtime, and she wants to be satisfied. She wants to see God's work in action. She's not trying to replace things. She's not trying for a different order from what God intended. She says, yes, Lord. She's affirming God's order. And notice the response. Verse 28. Then Yeshua answered, he said to her, O woman. Now, there is the Greek letter omega before the term woman. Why is that? This definite article here is for the purpose of emphasizing, causing it to stand out. Now, it's not a definite article in the pure sense, but it's a word that emphasizes, makes the passage emphatic. And he says, we could translate it, O woman, great is your faith. Let it be for you or to you as you will. What a wonderful statement. He says, O woman, great is your faith. What is one of the ways to understand faith? Faith is when we agree with God. I've said many times in Hebrew, the word for faith, emunah, is also related to the Hebrew word emet, truth. Faith is when we say yes, we agree, we implement God's truth into our life. That's what faith is. Faith is not something you simply choose to believe. Faith is when you choose to respond to the truth of God. Just because you believe it with all your heart doesn't mean that you're being faithful. It's when you believe the truth of God with all your heart, then that produces faithfulness. So he says, O woman, great is your faith. Let it be done to you, and that can mean for you, as your will. And verse 28, the end, it says, and this word and is an important conjunction. It unites two things, and what is that? It's uniting this woman's faith and the outcome of faith. And what is that? God moving. God acting. God restoring. And notice we read here, and her daughter was healed. Now, the term was healed is in the passive. You must pay attention to the grammar, because what that tells us is this. This little girl was not healed simply because of a chance, simply because God said, okay, I'll do it. There was something that brought it about. And what was that? Faith. It's in the passive saying something acted, something brought about, something caused this healing. And what is that? This great faith of this woman. And her daughter was healed from that hour. Now, the last thing I want to say here about this text is that this preposition is important. From that hour. And the implication is this. It means from that time onward. This was not something that was just a occurrence that was going to last for a few moments. No, she was healed. That demonic influence, that power, never approached her, never visited her again. This is how we know that it was a heavenly healing, that it was based upon the power of the God himself. We need to realize something. There are too many people today not affirming the order of God. Why do I say that? Well, many people are setting aside Israel. They're setting aside the significance of the land of Israel. And they believe, in fact, there's a theology that teaches this. It's called replacement theology that says God has finished with the Jewish people. Now, if they want to receive the gospel, that's fine. But there's no more significance, these false teachers say, to the land of Israel. There is no more relevance to that covenant agreement that God made with Abraham and then affirmed to Yitzhak and then to Jacob, Jacob and his descendants. They say all of that has been canceled out. No, it hasn't. And when people teach that, you need to run from these individuals. They are not illiterate people of the scripture. We see over and over how God is working and bringing the people back to the land. Why? This is one of the clearest indicators that we are approaching the last time, the last days. And what does that mean? It means this, that God is going to work according to his order, and he is going to bring about the outcome of God's order, and that is the kingdom of God and all the events that lead up to the establishment of the kingdom of God. Shalom from Israel.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of LoveIsrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, LoveIsrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with him. Shalom from Israel.